We actually just had a discovery of a previously unrecognized developmental disease. And that has been a wonderful collaboration with clinicians at NIH who saw patients that had a mutation in a particular enzyme. And in these enzymes, my lab has been really interested in previously. So we're trying to understand basic mechanism about these enzymes. So that has resulted in a wonderful collaboration between clinicians at NIH, so David's lab, and my lab. And we really could, by starting to ask the question, how do the mutations in this enzyme result in developmental disease, we made some really interesting findings about novel biology that we haven't known before.
The project really started from a patient that I met and a family that I met. So as a clinical geneticist, I'm called to see patients where there's a suspicion for a genetic diagnosis. And this family had a sick newborn baby. And they had had two previous sick newborn babies that had multiple different birth defects. So, and they wanted to know what the prognosis is and the diagnosis for the patient. So part of my role is to try and help provide that. And despite the efforts of other clinicians and geneticists, they hadn't been able to find a known diagnosis. So we dove into the unknown and tried to find something that hadn't previously been found. And that's kind of where these efforts have led us, is to finding this new genetic diagnosis, in part to provide answers for the original family that we met. The difficult part about this this discovery is that OTUD5 wasn't known prior to our work to be involved in development. So we had to kind of work from scratch to figure out how this enzyme may be involved in regulating different components of embryonic development. And I think the challenges are is that the enzyme has this very unique activity removing ubiquitin chains. So to kind of couple the specific activity of what types of ubiquitin chains it edits at distinct times during development was challenging, but also very rewarding, because we were able to uncover this pathway that was exquisitely well controlled during a specific stage during neuronal development.
I think what I was most surprised and excited about is to realize that the way we started this project was very different from how I usually did it. So we did it from a human genetics perspective. We studied patient mutations. And through studying the patient mutation, we discovered something that we wouldn't have discovered otherwise, because the patient mutation had just like a very precise mutation and only took away part of the activity, not all of the activity. And that actually allowed us to make the discovery that we made. So I think that excited me the most, to realize we discovered something that nobody ever discovered because we took this unique approach.
As I mentioned, it's one of the most rewarding parts of this project is being able to come back to patients and provide diagnoses. And, you know, for the original family that I saw that I was initiated this project based on, They had been through such a long process having multiple children with this disease that they were sort of already were done looking for answers. So it was very surprising that they could even find an answer at this point. But I'd say that the more rewarding part has come from new patients that we've identified, where the odyssey hasn't been as long, where they haven't been looking for answers for a long time, and they're able to get an answer. And you know, the knowing that they don't have to look and that they can find that it has been, and that I can help answer their questions has been great for them and for us.
I don't work with patients, but what has been really rewarding over the last 3 years is that coming here to the NIDCR, coming to the NIH campus and seeing the big research hospital here and seeing all these patient cohorts that come in, that the research that I do as a trained biochemist and researcher who uses human pluripotent stem cells as the model system, that the mechanistic questions that excite me, that I can do that now for the benefit of patients. So while I don't see them myself, I can contribute basically to some of the things that Dr. Beck just said. So it's very rewarding.
I think one of the lessons that I've learned from this project and from my work as a geneticist is that the patients that we see hold a lot of benefit for our research. So both in terms of being able to provide answers for them, and that understanding their disease can provide us insights into important biology. So my suggestion is to listen to your patient, to try to understand their diagnosis, and to not stop when it's not a conventional diagnosis, because some of those confounding questions may enlighten areas of biology that you wouldn't expect, and sort of to let the serendipity of discovery go forward.
Yeah, I think there were in particular two aspects that surprised me about our findings. And the first one was to see that OTUD5, the enzyme that we've been studying, is actually signaling and controlling embryonic development by a kind of a new principle that of signaling that we hadn't appreciated before. And it works through targeting a group of functionally related substrates, the so-called like chromatin regulators, so proteins that control gene expression. Which then brings me to my second point that I was very surprised and also excited about, is to see that out of those group of substrates, the chromatin regulators, when mutated, they also lead to distinct diseases, but that have phenotypic overlap with our linked patients. So this suggests basically that we discovered a very fundamental pathway that when you mutate it at different points, it will lead to a spectrum of disease. So this is something I think that's very interesting, and that's something that we should follow up in the future. I can just say a little bit of what I like about coming here to the NIH as a young tenure tracker. And I think one of the great things about coming here to the NIH is that there's the StatMed program where you come as an investigator, as a cohort, and you get to know your other people or other scientists who start their lab at the same time, which fosters a nice community. And basically you start talking to each other, you realize that people are working on different aspects of science, but that, you know, can potentially help you. And I think that also helped us in the for this project to discover Link syndrome. We in the end had the question of, well, OTUD5 regulates these chromatin regulators and gene expression, but how does that work in molecular detail? And there we could make use of our knowledge of Pedro Roca, who's an investigator at the National Institutes of Child Health and Development, who helped us figuring out how OTUD5 regulates gene expression in the end, with bringing in his expertise.
I think this project is just an example of the kind of collaborative work that can occur at the NIH, and that that I'm happy to be a participant in. It's just tremendous to be able to have different groups and institutes share their expertise to help answer these questions. And, you know, between the National Human Genome Research Institute and the National Institute of Dental Cranial Facial Research working so closely together, the Undiagnosed Disease Program. I mean, there have been a lot of people who've been involved in this work, and I don't think that it could have been as complete without all this teamwork. So I'm very thankful for that, and I think it's a shining example.